wife. Anybody know where I can find one? That's a great intro to our couples retreat. Good. Thank you for coming up, Miss Margie. Well, good morning, everybody. Woo, a little hot right here. Good morning. Switch sides. All right. I feel weird on this side, though. Good morning, everybody. Good to see you today. Welcome to the house of the Lord. Everybody good and toasty, warm in here? I'm not going to turn up the heat. You'll go to sleep on me. All right. So, but we're going to turn up the heat with the name of Jesus. Amen. Because he is the fire, the consuming fire. Amen. So good to see you today. Welcome to the house of the Lord. If you're a guest with us today, we have what's called a connection card. All right. Would you grab one of these? They're at the little tables right there that are covered in white. Would you grab one of these connection cards and fill that out? Drop it in the bucket as you leave. Also, if you have prayer requests or maybe you're making a decision today. You know, some people won't come forward. And you know what? That's okay. There's something special about coming forward to the altar of God. But I want you to know this. You can put on this card, my decision is this today, and I'll get with you during the week, all right? And we'll talk about your decision that you've made in Christ Jesus. So use these connection cards, drop them in the bucket. We'll get with you during the week, all right? And if you're a guest with us today, welcome. We're so glad you're here with us today. I see some of our northern families back home. Praise God. All right, good to see y'all. Good to see everybody in the house today. Would you stand and greet somebody next to you and tell them, man, you're looking good in the cold weather.
Good morning, everybody. Well, some of you are awake. Good morning, everybody. It's great for us to be back. We fought through a lot of headaches in the last 6 weeks, but we're glad to be back. We're going to start with These Are the Days of Elijah.
These are the days of Elijah, declaring the word of the Lord. And these are the days of your servant Moses, righteousness being restored. And though these are days of great trials, of famine and darkness and sore, still we are the voice in the desert, crying, prepare ye the way of the Lord. Behold, he comes, riding on the clouds, shining like the sun. At the trumpet calls, oh, lift your voice. It's a year of jubilee, and out of Zion till salvation comes. These are the days of Ezekiel, the dry bones becoming as flesh. And these are the the days of your servant David, rebuilding the temple of praise. And these are the days of the harvest. The fields are as wide in your word. Still we are the laborers in your vineyard, declaring the word of the Lord. Behold, he comes, riding on the clouds, shining like the sun. At the trumpet call, so lift your voice. It's a year of jubilee, and out of Zion's hill salvation comes.
This is the easy part.
There's no God like Jehovah. 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 Behold, he comes, riding on the clouds, shining like the sun. At the trumpet call, so lift your voice. It's the year of Jubilee, and out of Zion's hill salvation comes. And out of Zion's hill salvation comes.
Amen. Good to have y'all back. Welcome back. I know you've been through a lot. Man, that song means a lot to you, doesn't it? All the troubles and trials and all, but God is faithful. Amen. Listen to this from Psalm chapter 3. It says, "Arise, O Lord, save me, O God." Anybody want some of that today? You know, salvation is not just the one-time experience where you give your life to Christ. God is saving all the time, isn't he? Amen? All right? Some of y'all not getting that. Come on now. All right, but listen to this. He goes on a little bit farther. In verse 8 says, "Salvation belongs to the Lord. Your blessing is upon your people." Look at your neighbor and say, "You blessed." Who's your blessing come from? His name is God. Amen. Would you pray with me? Father, thank you for salvation in you. Thank you, God, that we can trust in you. Thank you, God, that you're amazing. God, we know this, that you have risen. We know this, that you also rise up all the time and come to our saving need. God, thank you for that. Lord, you are the salvation throughout all of history. That never changes. And God, I pray that we will always remember our salvation is in you. Our trust is in you. God, our hope is in you. And one day we know you're coming back to set all things right. And we look forward to that day. So we come now, worshiping our salvation in you, worshiping you because you are salvation, and also looking forward to the blessed hope, the blessing of your return when all things are set right. So God, we worship you today. We cry out to you. We say, Abba, Father. We love you, Lord. And all God's people said, amen.
He came to sin, who knew no sin, that we might become his righteousness. He humbled himself, carrying the cross. Love so amazing. Blessed Redeemer. ransom from heaven. Jesus, Messiah, Lord of all. His body, the
the Lord has
the sun forbear to shine, but God, you call me here below, will be forever mine, will be forever mine.
You
I got a little problem that my hand goes numb when I play.
I can only imagine what it will be like when all by your side. I can only imagine what my eyes will see when your face is before me. I can only imagine. I can only imagine. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus? Or in awe of you be still? Will I stand in your presence? To my knees will I fall? Will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak at all? I can only imagine. I can only imagine. I can only imagine. When that day comes and I find myself standing in the sun, I can only imagine when all I would do is forever worship you. I can only imagine. I can only imagine. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus? Or in awe of you be still? Will I stand in your presence? To my knees will I fall? Will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak at all? I can only imagine. Yeah. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus? Or in all of you be still? Will I stand in your presence? To my knees will I fall? Will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak it all? I can only
can be seated, church. We're going to release our kids now to kids' church. If you're a pre-K all the way up through fifth grade, you're welcome to go to kids' church as we sing you out of here, right? Amen. So on that note, we're going to be studying the Word of God. Y'all ready? We had 79 in small group Bible study this morning. Would y'all give God a big hand for that? Amen. Thanks for getting up and suffering through the cold of Green Bay, Florida. Getting into Bible study. Oh, Jonathan said, we think we're cold. If we went up a little farther north, we'd be cold, wouldn't it? Quite a few years ago, my family and I were a part of a church in Georgia, and we were involved in the church and, you know, attended very regularly, and we did things. We were part of a lot of the activities, and, you know, I don't know if this has ever happened to you. I began to drift away a little bit. I began to get away from the activities of the church. I excused myself time after time with work obligations or whatever it might be or other things that were going on, you know. Now, I'm a man called of God to preach the Word of God, but I drifted. My neighbors across the street were also of the same church fellowship, and I can remember that we had gotten fairly close because we did a lot of things together church-wise, and, you know, I happened to be out of church a couple of Sundays in a row, and my neighbor came over to see how I was doing. We took a little ride to the store because I needed to go to the store for some reason. I don't know what it was, and honestly, I kind of said that hoping that he would kind of go away. But he said, well, I'll just ride with you. So he rode in the truck with me, and we went down to the store, and he asked me how I was doing because he said that I hadn't been in church and doing the activities, and he said, and I noticed you've been out a little bit, and so I covered it up with work stuff and, you know, said those things like that, things that I really needed to do. And he said, well, you know, next week is Father's Day. Are you going to be working next week, next Sunday? And I said, no, I'm not. Not going to be working next Sunday. He said, oh, cool. I said, but I've been given tickets to the Devil Rays game. And my favorite ball player is going to be there, Cal Ripken. You've probably heard of him. And I said, listen, this may be the last time I get to see him live. And I would love to go down there, and I want to take my son. What a great Father's Day that will be. My neighbor said, oh, man, that's great. I hope you have a great time. I told him, yeah, I will, because I love Cal Ripken and hanging out with my son, watching baseball. Man, you can't get much better than that. Justin and I went down to the game on Sunday and had a great time. My neighbor came back during the week. And he said, hey, man, how's the game? Did you have a good time? And I said, yeah, we had a blast. I really enjoyed it. And I talked to him about what had happened and all. And then he said, Don, can I talk to you for just a minute? And I said, sure. And he said, I've been noticing that you've not done as much of the activities of the church. And now you've started to miss a few Sundays in a row. And he said, and when you were not at work, you made the decision to go watch a ball game instead of coming to worship. He said, I'm not your judge in no way, and I'm not trying to be. He said, can I just ask you what's going on? Church, what my neighbor didn't know that I was really struggling in my relationship with God. I was really fighting a battle in my own self because I'd made some mistakes and choices that were not in line of who I said I was in Christ. And every time it was time to go to church, you know what? I tried to find a way out because I didn't want to go in there and face the fact that I needed to get things right. I called myself a hypocrite because that's what I was. But I thought, you know what? If I go to church, I'll even be a bigger hypocrite. I was starting to look for those excuses not to be there instead of having the desire to be there and get things right. You see, what I had done as I was wandering from the truth. So I want to say this into the camera right now because, hey, Todd Burke, if you're out there right now, can I tell you thank you? Thank you for loving me enough to keep coming back. Thank you for loving me enough to challenge me on my faith. Thank you, Todd Burke, because you're part of the responsibility why I'm in this pulpit today. Thank you, Todd. I love you. Take a look around you. Are there people missing today that should be here? People that maybe you've missed for a little while and maybe you need to give them a call. Maybe you need to stop by their house. Maybe you need to send them a letter, a note, something. The top of your sermon notes, there are two blank lines. I want you to spend a minute, this first minute, before we dive into the Word of God, and it, by the way, pertains exactly to what James is going to tell us today as we finish out the book of James. 6 months we've been in it. We're going to finish it out today. But I want you to write that name up there, name or names. Somebody that when you look around, or maybe somebody that you know, maybe you've been thinking about this already. You know, I need to give so-and-so a call. Would you write their name down there? Now, once you've done that, would you turn with me to James chapter 5? James chapter 5. Y'all thought we was all done, didn't you? Two last verses that James gives us, and I think you'll understand exactly what's going on here, why I opened up with that story and what James is talking about. So would you stand with me? James chapter 5, verse 19 and 20. Everybody there with me, say amen.
Amen.
All right. Anybody excited about hearing from God?
Amen.
All right, let's do this. Brethren, if anyone among you wanders from the truth and someone turns him back, let him know that he who turns a sinner from the error of his way will save a soul from death and cover a multitude of sins. Woo-hoo! Oh, James, don't you love James? Finishing a letter out with all this flowery stuff. Y'all, some of y'all don't get that. This ain't a very flowery ending. This is another challenge. This is another test. This is another saying, let's get into action. So, y'all, let's pray about this and let's really discover what James is telling us, all right? Father God, we love you and praise you. Lord, we come to you today finishing up the book of James, but God, we're not finished with what we need to be doing. God, we are still called and commissioned to go out into the highways and hedges and compel them to come in. We're still called, God, to be what you have given me as a title of this message today, to be rescuers of those who have wandered from the truth. So, Father, my prayer is today we would hear your word, we would heed your word, and then we would go out and live your word in this community and abroad. Father, thank you for calling us into kingdom work on a kingdom mission. And God, you didn't leave us alone in that. You said, and I will be with you even to the end of the age. Thank you, Father. We love you and we praise you. And all God's people said, amen. All right, check it out, church, as you're being seated. Here we go. James closes the letter with some really blunt words. Would you agree? But why would we expect anything less from old James? Right? Why would we expect anything less as he closes? In fact, he started. Let's remember, I want to give you a little backdrop of what we've been studying over the last 6 months. Remember when he started, he said this in verse 1 and 2 of James chapter 1. My brethren, count it all joy when you fall into various trials, knowing that the testing of your faith produces patience. Boom. Don't you love opening up a letter like that? Yeah? Getting right to the point. James is a get-to-the-point kind of guy, isn't he? We've seen it all through his letter. So instead of using some kind of flowery words, like I was saying, at the end of his letter, he closes with one last call to action. So before we move on, though, I think we need to clear something up really quick, okay? Because when you look at this, in fact, let me read it to you again. Let's go back and read it again. We may read it two or three times during the message. Brethren, if anyone among you wanders from the truth and someone turns him back, let him know that he who turns a sinner from the error of his way will save a soul from death and cover a multitude of sins. let's kind of clear the mud a little bit. Who is James writing about, believers or unbelievers? Listen, when James refers to those among his audience that have wandered from the truth, is he referring to fellow believers who have fallen into sin, or is he referring to those within the body who claim to be believers but who have never genuinely started following Christ? One of the things I want to propose to you is that shouldn't matter to us. Come on, church. Anybody hearing? Regardless, we should be going after to rescue them. Amen? Okay, all right. So you're catching the point, all right? So let me go a little bit farther. Some of the well-known scholars and pastors have made reasonable arguments to support both positions. But one hand, James is calling the sinners, and like in the New Testament, sinners is a term that's usually, but not always, used to refer to those who have never dealt with their sin and come to the saving knowledge of Jesus Christ. But also, look around you. Those of us who are saved and in the faith still can sin. Would you agree? So we still are sinners. But we also are known this in this way, and it's a struggle for us to believe this. We're saints as well in the faith. But we still sin, we still struggle. Now, in just a minute, we'll deal with what James means by death, because you see that in there. But at least on the surface, the idea of saving a soul from death also tends to lend support to the idea that James is writing about unbelievers. On the other hand, James does address his audience as my brothers. Did you see this? And the idea of bringing back someone who has wandered from the truth sounds more like James has a fellow believer in mind here. Could be either way, though, couldn't it? Here we go. James, is he writing about physical death or spiritual death? Well, although the English translation says save a soul from death, sounds like James is writing about spiritual death. Listen, the words that he uses could actually refer to physical death as well. In fact, James uses the same word save in verse 15. If you look back, excuse me, just back a little bit, and the prayer of faith will save the sick. Did you hear that? A physical reference. Okay? So, the rest of the words in this phrase really doesn't give us much more help, but the words translated soul can be used either to describe the immaterial part of the man that survives death and lives eternal, or it could be used to describe the entire person. And the word translated death is used in the New Testament to describe both physical and spiritual death. So generally, those who believe that James is writing about here about believers also hold that James is writing about physical death. In that case, now grab this, the sense of this passage is that bringing back a wayward believer can actually save that person from experiencing physical death, much like Paul wrote in 1 Corinthians about taking the Lord's Supper unworthily, which could lead to death. Wow. Isn't that powerful, church? So which one is right? Can I suggest to you, why does it matter? Because if someone is drifting, someone is wayward, it's up to us, like Todd Burke did for me, go rescue them. Amen? Go rescue them. So, let me explain. We've seen James's letter in full, all the tests that he has given us. Y'all, we need to grab this today. Let's go back through and walk through James, the book of James. For a genuine and mature Christian, chapter 1 says we need to cultivate joy in the midst of our trials. A genuine, mature Christian needs to be cultivating joy in the midst of trials. Boy, it's hard, isn't it? But that's what God wants for us. Joy in the midst of trials. Here we go further on in chapter 1. A genuine, mature Christian needs to triumph over temptation. We need to know this. We're set free from temptation and it doesn't hold us anymore. My chains are gone. I've been set free. Right? Here's the next one. A genuine, mature Christian embraces doing the word, not just hearing it. Woo! I didn't hear as many amens right there. Amen, right? Okay? We want to not just hear the word, but do the word. Here's another one. Oh, chapter 2 got a little bit deeper, y'all. A genuine, mature Christian prevents partiality by looking at every person through the lens of the gospel. Everyone deserves to have an opportunity to be saved. Amen? That's the way we need to look at them. Because God said, whosoever, didn't he? Okay, the next one in chapter 2. A genuine, mature Christian demonstrates their faith by their works. You can see a Christian, you can know a Christian because they're working out their faith. Amen? Here's another one in chapter 2. No, excuse me, chapter 3. A genuine, mature Christian speaks words of life instead of death. You don't speak death over people. You speak life into them because you have life in Jesus Christ. Amen? That's what a genuine, mature Christian does. Here's another one. Genuine, mature Christians in chapter 3, James says, demonstrates heavenly wisdom with a humble heart. Remember, we discovered heavenly versus terrible, evil wisdom. We discovered that. So what do you walk in? A genuine, mature Christian walks in the heavenly wisdom because you seek after it. Amen? Here's another one. Genuine, mature Christians in chapter 4 engages in righteous discernment. You seek God to discern what's going on. Boy, in a day and age like this, how much do we need that, y'all? Seeking God's discernment. A genuine, mature Christian in chapter 4 becomes the person God wants them to be by following God's will. Another test. Here's another one. We just learned this a couple of weeks ago. A genuine, mature Christian uses his wealth as a faithful steward. We give and we don't hoard, right? We give as God gave to us. Here's another one. A genuine, mature Christian endures today's hurts through tomorrow's hope. I'm hurting today, but it's nothing compared to the glory of tomorrow when I'm in heaven. Amen? And last week we learned this one. A mature, genuine Christian makes prayer a priority. You know why? Because that's communion with God. He's number one, and I'm seeking after number one. So, we certainly need to use all of this that James has given y'all to evaluate our personal lives, but also, listen to this, and this is touchy, because how many people have heard this before? When you come to somebody like Todd Burke came to me, and they ask you the question of what's going on, you've heard this, you're judging me. You're judging me. Well, let me just tell you something. I knew Todd Burke wasn't judging me. I knew who was. I know who sent Todd Burke over to my house. It wasn't Todd Burke. It was God. Can you imagine Todd walking over there? What am I going to say to him? Have y'all ever been there? What am I going to say? What am I going to do? So listen to this. Second, it would be appropriate for us to see these tests and evaluate our own lives, but also evaluate people's lives in the body of Christ. That's hard though, isn't it? So I'm going to talk to you about how do we do this in such a way, how do we rescue someone in such a way where it's not about us, it's about Him doing the rescue through us. Hello, God's calling. How does He do it through us? Because listen, y'all, only God is in the position to make the evaluation and the judgment. So now I hope you see that it really doesn't make a difference whether James is referring to unbelievers or believers who have temporarily strayed from the truth. Our responsibility is the same, either case. Perhaps it's why it's left a little vague. So we realize it's for both. Listen, church, your first note, here we go. Regardless of whether that straying sinner is genuine, a genuine brother or sister in Christ or an unbeliever, our responsibility is clear. Here it is, right under those names, write this, rescue them. Rescue them. A young man once described going astray from God. Here's how he described it. He said, it was like that I was out in a deep water, in the deep sea, and in deep trouble. And all my friends were on the shoreline hurling biblical accusations about justice, penalty, and wrongdoing at me. But there was one Christian brother who actually swam out to get me and would not let go. I fought him, but he pushed aside my fighting. He grasped me. He put a life vest on me and took me to shore. By the grace of God, he was the reason I was restored. He would not let me go. Man, that's good, isn't it? Surely James, his audience that he was writing to in this letter, God would have brought to mind somebody in their life that they'd seen wander from the truth. Maybe someone that never had come to the saving knowledge of Jesus, but somebody they probably thought of. And out of genuine love and concern for those people, James was calling on his brothers and sisters to go and on a rescue mission in order to bring those people back into the fellowship. James probably heard his half-brother Jesus tell the story of the lost sheep. Check it out, Matthew 18, 12 through 14. Check it out. What do you think? If a man has 100 sheep and one of them goes astray, does he not leave the 99 and go to the mountains to seek the one that is straying? And if he should find it, assuredly, I say to you, he rejoices more over that sheep than over the 99 that did not go astray. Even so, it is not the will of your Father who is in heaven that one of these little ones should perish. Right in line with Scripture that says it's not God's will that any should perish, but all should come to the saving knowledge of Jesus Christ. Amen. It's very interesting in these words that Jesus said, the same words going astray translates to wandering or wanders. Right here from James 5. So when we engage in rescuing those that have wandered or gone astray from the truth, we are actually, y'all listen to this, please write this down, partnering with God in the process of rescuing them. Anybody ever want to go on a rescue mission with God? You can every day. Every day you can have that opportunity. And here's how you do it. How to rescue a straying sinner. Anybody want to know? Well, if you don't, I got to go. But I want to tell you how to rescue a straying sinner. Sign up to do it. You first, number one, sign up to do it. Contrary to many thoughts, let me get in your kitchen a minute. The task of rescuing straying sinners is not just up to the pastor. I say that in all kind of love. But here's what I hear more than any other thing, it seems like. Pastor, so-and-so in my family's really struggling. Can you come talk to them? I can. I will. I'll tell them about Jesus. But can I tell you this? God put it on your heart. God revealed them to you. You be used by God. Sign up for the rescue mission. And let God do it through you. How awesome would it be? How many of you have ever led somebody to Christ and it feels like you're in the birthing room of somebody? Or maybe somebody has gone astray and you give them a truth from the Word of God and it's like the prodigal coming home and you're not the older brother, you're the father. Man, it pumps you up, doesn't it? It encourages you in the faith. So listen, it's not up to pastors and deacons and other leaders in the church, not just up to us, it's up to all of us. We're all given the ministry of reconciliation. When James addresses the issue with his brothers, he makes it clear that every believer is responsible to sign up for the spiritual search and rescue team and get involved in these efforts. When we engage in rescuing straying sinners, here's what we're doing, y'all. We're merely fulfilling the command that Jesus gave all of his followers. Here it is. Go therefore and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all things that I've commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the age. And Jesus liked it so much, he said, amen. So be it. Listen, church, in your notes, an important part of developing disciples is to help them recognize the devastating impact that sin has on their lives and the life of the church, the life of people around them. Once a person realizes the devastation that sin causes in their life, the person is more likely to come to the awareness of the need for faith in Jesus Christ, the only one that can set them free. And listen, we're all called to make disciples. So look at your neighbor and say, we're supposed to be making disciples. Some of y'all did not participate. Can I tell you something? In all kind of love, that's the problem in America. The church ain't participating. We're not telling people about Jesus. And we wonder why we're in the state that we're in. When we started this message today, I asked you to take a minute and think about who's missing that should be here. Hopefully you wrote down a name or names. Now it's time for you to sign up. It's time for you to sign up and be on the rescue mission. Listen, church, don't stand on the seashore and hurdle biblical accusations toward these people. Swim out to them. Come on. Swim out to them. It's time to get on the rescue mission. Number two, search your heart. Search your heart. Although we have the responsibility to get involved in the lives of those who have strayed from the truth, we have to make sure we do that with the right motives. This is not a notch in our belt. It is kingdom work. All for the glory of God. Amen? James has already addressed the need for right motives frequently throughout his letter. A little bit more review. Chapter 1, he said, quick to listen, slow to speak, slow to anger. So let me ask you this. Are you angry with straying sinners because they're not living correctly? Here's who you should be mad at, the devil, who's convincing them not to. Go rescue them. Here's another one. Are you upset that they're not serving in the church like you are? Are you ticked that it seems like they are having all the fun and you're tied down to church service? Maybe you ought to check your heart, search your heart. Chapter 2, James warned about becoming judges with evil thoughts. Chapter 3, James deals with the tongue and emphasizes the need to speak words of life. Build up with beautiful words and not tear down with words. Chapter 4, James teaches us about unrighteous condemnation in order to make ourselves look better. I'll go rescue them because that makes me look good. When we apply all that we've learned in James to our rescue work, y'all, it's clear that this work must be done out of love and a pure heart. We need to do that because we love God and we love people, which is what we stand on at this church. It's actually our mission for this church. Love God and love people. Love God passionately. Love our community unconditionally. We are First Baptist Church of Webster. Paul addressed this issue as well in Galatians chapter 6. Would you turn with me there too, please? Turn to Galatians chapter 6. Go to the left in your Bible. I have it up on the Jumbotron for you, but I really want you to see this in the Word and maybe mark it, because we're going to walk through this for just a second. Here we go. Brethren, if a man is overtaken in any trespass, you who are spiritual, restore such a one in a spirit of gentleness, considering yourself, lest you also be tempted. In verse 2, bear one another's burdens, and so fulfill the law of Christ. Now, since we're searching our heart, let's do a little search through this scripture. You ready with me? Here we go. The first thing that Paul says, you who are spiritual. What is he talking about this? This should tell us to check ourselves first, much like Jesus said in the Sermon on the Mount, where he said this: before you go try to get a speck out of somebody's eye, get the log out of your own. Okay? So you who are spiritual, you better go into it with a spiritual mindset that is being led by the Holy Spirit to go on this rescue mission. So search your heart in this way, you who are spiritual. Make sure you're walking in the Spirit of God, not in your flesh, when you're on a rescue mission of a straying sinner. Here's number two, the second thing, a spirit of gentleness. Have you ever seen a firefighter or other rescue workers operate? Man, I get into some of this. I'm scared to death, but I get into this because one of the things that you notice is a gentleness. The firefighter coming in with all that equipment or all that, all the tooling and all that, but yet what does he do when he finds someone trapped in some rubble? They don't just start throwing stuff off. They gently look at the situation and then they start to remove things because they don't want to cause more harm. Anybody with me? You get the picture here? When we search our heart, y'all, it's easy for us to just dive in and say, well, I'll tell you what you ought to be doing. You might be causing more harm than good. So be gentle. Be gentle in the Spirit, listening to the Holy Spirit. What is the Holy Spirit telling you to do? You see, our goal is bringing restoration, not causing more harm. Anybody hearing that? Thirdly, considering yourself, lest you also be tempted. It's very straightforward, isn't it? We must approach our spiritual rescue mission with a great deal of humility, understanding that so go I. If I'm not careful, I could be the same way. I am prone to wonder just like anybody else in this house and anybody in this community. Fourth, bear one another's burdens. This says to me, listen to the straying sinner that you're trying to rescue. A good and caring rescuer will ask this: what is hurting? Can you hear me? Are you breathing well? You see all this? What you're doing is you're putting yourself in their position in order to understand better how they're dealing with this, how they're struggling. We need to, is that the word teachers help me, empathize? We get right in there with them. We bear their burdens. And lastly, fulfill the law of Christ. What is the law of Christ? Love one another as I have loved you. So, what are your motives in the rescue? Bottom line, if it's because you love the straying sinner, then all the other stuff will fall into place. So search your heart. Here's number three, seek and speak the truth. A careful examination of the words used by James in this close of his letter reveals the root issue that we must deal with. So let's go back and look at it. Here we go again. Brethren, if anyone among you wanders from the truth and someone turns him back, let him know that he who turns a sinner from the error of his way will save a soul from death and cover a multitude of sins. So James uses the term wonder to describe the nature of the problem here. As we have seen, the word can also mean to go astray or even be to be deceived. How many times have you seen somebody in life that is bought into a lie from something or someone? They're being deceived, y'all. You do know who the deceiver is, right? And he, by the way, is described as the father of lies. So he can deceive even those who are of the faith. We can fall away. We can get trapped, as we've seen. But the key here is to see what the person has wandered from and what they are wandering to. The person has wandered from the truth. At first, we might assume that James is referring here to someone who has been deceived by someone, some kind of false doctrine. And that certainly can be true. But I want you to hear this. Man, and when I studied and broke this down, this was so good. James, though, has the concept of truth, and it's much more in line with the Hebrew idea of truth. Listen to this. The Hebrew word for truth means something that is firm and stable. This. Firm and stable. You don't have to doubt if this is truth. You don't have to question whether God is, His truth is this today, but it might be that tomorrow. No, He's the same yesterday, today, and forever. His truth stands. Excuse me, it's stable and it's full. So to the Hebrews, listen to this though, truth is not just about correct doctrine though, it's also about the development of godly character in the life of a person. That's why the Word of God says, the truth shall set you free. Also, it says for us to continue to pursue and want the truth because it builds our life in truth. We become stable and firm. So this is really the essence of James's letter, isn't it? A person who hangs out on the truth rather than wanders away from it will live in a way that reflects that truth in every area of his or her life. The straying sinner, on the other hand, has not only wandered away from the truth, y'all, but they have literally chosen to cling to his wandering. Back to our text, let him know that he who turns a sinner from the error of whose way? His way, that's not a capital H. That is the truth that the person who has wandered wants to believe is truth. And it might be like this, y'all. Day after day. Don't know what truth is. But this seems like truth today, so this is what I'm going to believe. James says, error of his way. In other words, he or she is choosing to live by his or own idea of truth rather than God's truth. So listen, church, it should not be surprising to us that people, even those claiming to be Christians, wander from the truth. A study in the Barna Group of 2009, listen to this, revealed that less than half of those who claim to be born-again believers believe that truth is absolute and unaffected by circumstances. That's people of the faith, people in the church. Less than half believe that truth is absolute. So just know there will be people who leave, wander from the truth because they do not want the truth to be absolute. They want it to be conducive to their circumstances. So listen carefully. Any attempts to rescue these people must not be accompanied by the temptation to water down or stray from the truth. It's our responsibility to be, I love this term, truth dispensers. Isn't that good? Truth dispensers, not compromisers or ear ticklers. That's not what the world needs. There's plenty of that going on. People need truth, amen? Listen to 1 Corinthians chapter 13. It says, love rejoices in the truth. You rejoice in the truth? Then give people truth. Seek it and speak it. Amen? When they train up lifeguards, y'all, to be a lifeguard, that makes sense, right? When they train them to be that, what they are, all right? Here's what they do is they say this, when you swim out to that person, they're floundering for their life. You with me? They're doing all they can to stay afloat. They don't want to drown and die. They're floundering. They're doing whatever they can to try to get in. When you get out there, you have to convince them that you're there to help. You don't just go out there and just start grabbing. Because here's the likely thing that's going to happen. You go down with them. They pull you down. So listen, we seek and speak the truth, and we do this, y'all, in such a way as to let people know, listen, I'm speaking the truth to you because I love you. Speak the word in truth because of your love. So the practical implication for those of us that have signed up in the rescue mission is to bathe these situations in prayer before you even go. Here's the last one. Stick to it. Just like Todd Burke did for me. Here's the illustration for that. In October 2010, some of you may remember, 33 Chilean miners were raised to the surface of the earth after 69 days being trapped in a mine. Anybody remember that? It was a feat of incredible engineering and amazing faith. And as many of you know, this was a story of sticking to it. Many people said there's no way that they're alive anymore. Many people said this, there's no way you can get down there. Many people said a lot of different things. Engineers struggled. We know all that. I don't know if you were like me, but every day I woke up, I kind of wanted to review. Did they get down there? Did they get them? How's things going? Whatever. That's the kind of persistence that is required in a spiritual rescue work. You cannot give up. Don't quit on those you've been praying for weeks and months and years. Don't quit. The work is hard, y'all. It's dirty sometimes. It can be discouraging, and you often don't see the results right away. Can I tell y'all something? That's the first time I told Todd Burke, thank you. But the consequences of straying from the truth are so damaging, we must not give up. Because when you bring somebody back, do you see what it says? You not only save that soul from death, but cover a multitude of sins. There's collateral damage when people keep wandering from the truth. In fact, the Hebrews writer said it so beautifully in Hebrews 13:3. Check it out. Remember the prisoners as if chained with them, those who are mistreated, since you yourselves are in the body also. What is he saying there? Listen, it's important to be persistent, as if you're attached to them. And knowing that this, the longer that they stay wandering away from the truth, the harder their hearts get, the more sin and collateral damage that's going to come to them and those around them. So here's how I want to close, y'all. I'm going to ask you to do three things. It's in your notes. We're going to fill in these blanks, but it ain't about filling in the blank. It's about putting it in your heart. Here's number one. Continue to ask God to reveal to you those who you know have wandered from the truth. Don't stop. Don't stop asking for God to put somebody in your life that you can lead to the truth, whether that be someone who's never accepted Christ or someone who's drifted away. How many of you know people that are no longer in the church? Whatever, for whatever reason, they've been hurt, whatever, or they've decided to drift. Some have even said, yeah, Jesus stuff just ain't for me, when they used to be walking with Him. Number two, commit to God to be a caring Christian who will be involved in the rescue mission of straying sinners. Commit to God that you're going to sign up. You're going to be a part of this rescue mission. And number three, ask God in prayer to prepare the hearts of straying sinners to be receptive to the truth and to reveal to you the most effective way to be a truth dispenser in their life. Church, if you don't go into this, as James says, for us to be rescuers with the right heart, speaking and seeking the truth, doing things according to the Spirit, you may cause more damage than you do good. But that doesn't mean don't do it. It means sign up and be a part of what James is saying. Amen? I've got a testimony I want you to hear real quick. I don't know how much longer we're going to be, but you need to just relax. Many of you saw Jerry last week, my brother-in-law, broken. Broken, but he came to church. You know why he came to church? Jerry, you didn't even tell me this, but I know. Because you know this is a place where you can get some comfort. This is a place where you can feel loved. This is a place when you're hurting, we come. Jerry came to the house yesterday, and we hung out together for a while with some other family, and he wanted to share something with me, and he said, "Can I give testimony today?" Can I tell you, I am so proud of this man. Jerry, I was so pumped when you called me and you told me you got saved. But can I tell you this? I'm so proud of you today because you're coming before the church and saying, "Hey, church, I've been hurting. And I want you to know that." And you know what? That's okay. How many of us walk around, y'all, and we do this? Oh, I come in here and I'm blessed and highly favored. And you walk out of here like this. You're hurting and you're hiding it. You're covering up. This man comes before us today. I'm so pumped about it. He's probably saying, "Well, get to it, preacher." But I'm so excited because he's saying, "I want you to know that there's people around you that are hurting. They need rescued." So, Jerry, come on up, my brother. Share. This one.
I want y'all to know that we've been through a lot here lately. As of December the 21st, my wife went in the hospital, COVID pneumonia. And I couldn't see her for 15 days. All I could do was get to the talk to the nurses and the doctors. But when she went in the emergency room, first call I got was, "What do you want to do with your wife? What's her wishes?" I told him, I said, "You do what you got to do to keep my wife with me." So that was on the 21st. The 23rd, they called and said they're going to have to incubate her and put the ventilator. The doc told me, said, "If we didn't do that she didn't have a chance." I said, "Do what you got to do, doc." So a couple days later, I get a call from another doctor. "What's your wishes? What do you want to do with your wife?" "I want my wife to come home. That's what I want." And then Sunday, I got to go see her the first time in 15 days. They gammed me up that thing. I walked into the room. I can't see her. She's got you sticking out of her mouth. Everywhere. I told her, I can't do it. But I did. I walked in there. She looked at me, and I looked at her. I said, "I love you." She got all these tubes sticking in her mouth and everything. She can't talk, but she does this. She goes, she's telling me she loves me back. Okay, so Tuesday, I go back in there. They dress me up in my gown and everything. We walk into the room. I don't even get to see her. "Get out of here. You got to go. You got to go somewhere. You got to go somewhere." I look, and there's a crash cart over there. The lady told me, she says, "If you're praying, man, let's go pray." So I went and prayed. She said, "You got to go to the conference room. Who can you call?" Does he get good? I couldn't get in touch with him, so I called Margie. It's just an emergency. Within 2 minutes later, Don called me back. Before we could even talk about what was going on, another nurse came in and says, "Okay, Mr. Hager, you can see your wife again." That put me on cloud 10. I got to talk to the doctor. He says, "Well, I'm going to tell you what happened." He said, "We took your wife down for a test, and when we brought her back up, her heart rate dropped a little bit, but we had it all under control. And I know for a fact, they didn't have it under control. God did." All these doctors telling me she ain't got no chance, they don't know what they're talking about, because we know who's got the chance. It's God. It's God. It's his decision who goes, who stays. That's right. So our aunt and uncle come down from Georgia last week, and I talked to them about three weeks ago. And I have spent every day with them to help me get over this. I'm not getting over it. It's going to be a long time. But I told them that what was going on. They knew what was going on. And I talked to them about what's going on right now. What should I do? Because on Thursday night, I woke up in a dead sleep. I mean, I was just wide awake. Showing me everything's been going on for the last month. And the Holy Spirit says, you've got to tell the congregation what is going on. You can't hide no more. So I you wake up, and I went back to sleep, and I woke up. What was that true? Was that true or not? And I talked to my uncle, told him. He says, you've got to tell him. So I called my brother. I said, Don, I got to talk to you. So he said, okay, come over Saturday. Saturday, I go over there. My aunt and uncle's over there. Talked to him. He says, about that time, Kimberly, Ryan, and Peanut come in. And I'm thinking, oh, my God, look at this. And then Don says, Justin will be here in a few minutes. The Lord put me in the right place for my family. I got a call. They moved my wife from South Lake Hospital to the specialty hospital in the Villages, which is a rehab for COVID patients. But the only problem with that is I can't see her for 3 months. I can see her through the window, but I can't talk to her. And I need y'all's help. I can't be alone for 3 months. I did it for 15 days, and it was okay, but for 3 months, I cannot do it without help from y'all. Y'all, my church family, and I told Don I didn't know how to ask, because I wanted to just keep it to myself, but just, no, you can't. You've got to let everybody know. So I'm just asking y'all to help me, because it's going to be a long 3 months, and I can't be by myself every day. Because I'll get back in that dark place again, and I don't want to go there. I want to thank y'all.
Hey, church. Guess what you just got called to? A rescue mission. God is so good. I had no idea that he was going to talk to us about this until Friday. I said, come over Saturday. God knew exactly what was going to go on, what I was preaching. But here we have a literal rescue story right in front of us. So church, here's what I first want you to do, is I want us to pray for Jerry. Thank you, worship team. We'll pray for Jerry. But I also want us to be in prayer for those that you wrote on your sheet, those that you know in your family that are hurting, but also those that you don't even know may be hurting that are sitting right in here. And that they would be willing to be rescued. You know, that's a big part of it too. We have to make a decision to say, okay, I need help. So maybe that's you today. Can I tell you the first step? Jerry testified to it. He said it was a beautiful sermon. We know who our rescue comes from. It's God. So it's got to start there. And then, of course, you trust in the family. That's why we're a church, right? So that we're there for one another and lift each other up and encourage one another. So if you've got hurts and struggles and pains, don't hide it away, please. Because the truth is, we all got stuff. If we were really honest. So, Jerry, thank you. I believe there's some things that have been broken through in the spirit world today because of your testimony. Because sometimes we can have strongholds around us and bind us up. And it takes somebody to just say, I need help. I can't do this alone. Father, we come before you and we thank you for Jerry's testimony. But God, we thank you that in that testimony, here's what he says, I need help and I really know where my help comes from. But God, we also know this, that the church is what you use to come to the rescue. The church is what you use to help one another out, to love one another. So God, I want to thank you for Jerry. Those 15 days were so awful. I know they were so hard. But yet, God, it's brought him to a point right now where he said, hey, church, I need to let you know. I need you. God, can I thank you for even the dark times? Much like Job was saying, no matter what, if I'm on the mountaintop or I'm in the valley, thank you, God, because you're there. You're worthy of praise. So, Father, thank you for Jerry. Thank you for the testimony of what you're doing in Kathy. God, we're seeing amazing things there. She's not out of the woods, but God, you're in the woods with her. We praise you for that. So, Father, thank you. Thank you that we can count on you. You are our hope. You're our security. You're our refuge and strength, our very present help in time of need. That's who you are. So, God, I move on from not just Jerry, but I think about all the other Jerrys that may be sitting in this house that are hurting with something, broken with something, been in a dark place. Maybe you've even been wandering from the truth. Maybe you're a prodigal today, and God brought you here for such a time as this so you could come back home, so you could come back to the one who really loves you, your rescuer. If that's you today, would you come forward today? Would you come forward and say, I'm coming back home, preacher. Let me pray with you. I've got deacons in the house that'll pray with you. We've got others in the house, church leaders. They'll pray with you. They won't judge you. They'll pray. Would you be willing to do that? And listen, there may be some in the house today that you've come to this place. You're wandering and just trying to find truth in a world that has no truth. It's not stable and firm. You're looking for that truth. Can I tell you the truth is in Christ Jesus? Would you come and let me tell you about him? Tell you how to get your feet planted on the rock, the firm foundation of Christ Jesus. Would you come and let us talk to you about that? You need to get saved. Get right with God and you'll be planted like a tree by a river. God, thank you for this calling. Thank you for what you're doing in our midst. Holy Spirit, move in this place. We surrender to you now. In the precious name of Jesus, amen.
It is like a river attendeth my way when sorrows like sea billows roll. Whatever my lot, thou hast taught me to say, it is well, it is well with my soul. Trials should come.
You to look at your neighbor, and I mean this with all the sincerity in your heart. Look at your neighbor around you and say, I'll be here for you. I'll be here for y'all. I'll be here for y'all. Love y'all. Now you get to live it out. They may call you. Can I tell you, that'll be a good thing. Because God is going to do that in you and through you, which you can't do on your own. You got to trust in the Holy Spirit. Amen? All right, I got a few announcements for you. Y'all be seated real quick. All right? First of all, give God a big hand for what He's done. Amen? Amen? Yeah, they got a video ready. Man, I am so pumped about this new sermon series coming, y'all. It's just three parts. Y'all are saying, really, preacher? You know it'll probably go out to about 10, though. Anyway, all right? But I want to tell you about some highlights we had this week, okay? A great highlight today was 79 people in Bible study. But we also had a great time yesterday. Some of us from the staff and Miss Tori went with us yesterday. We went out to three areas in our community that we'd already sent letters to sign up people to get back on our bus ministry. I thought that was kind of a rescue mission, right? So we went out to do that. Well, you know what? It was cold, really cold, and we didn't have a whole lot of people come out, but we did. We were able to sign up when we thought about it and looked at all. 14, is that what we decided, Tori? 14? 12? I'm a Baptist. I went a little high. 12 people we signed up for that. So would y'all give God a big hand for that outreach? Amen. Amen. All right, Acts tonight, winter Bible study is tonight. We're going into session two. You missed a little bit in session one, but you'll pick right up. Come on and be a part of that. The books are in. It's Rediscovering the Power of Christianity by J.D. Greer. It's so awesome. This Wednesday night at 7 p.m., baptism. Huh? We got a baptism going on this Wednesday night right over there in the old sanctuary. The water will be warm. All right? So y'all please come and support this. We've got two of our kids from our kids, one youth and one kid going to be baptized. But listen, if you need to know about baptism, put it on this connection card and let me talk to you. We'll do it Wednesday night. Okay? We'll move forward and get you walking in obedience with the Lord in baptism. So let me know about it. But Wednesday night at 7 p.m. Thursday night, Steve, we're going to have men's group Thursday night. Amen. All right, that means so be it. We are Kingdom Men, 6:30 Thursday night. This Saturday night, where's our youth director? Miss D, I can't believe you're going to go through with this. No, I'm just kidding. All right, this Saturday night, would you tell them what the youth are going to be doing? I love it. I love it. Just turn them loose in the yard out there. I love it. All right, so that's this Saturday, 5 to 9. Do they need to meet here or just come to your house?
If a student, we can meet some students here. Okay. Or they can just come to the house.
Okay.
We can make both of them work. If you would feel more comfortable with your student meeting here and being picked up here, we can do that. We can run them over to the house. It's just a couple of minutes. And if not, if you need our address, just let me know.
So see Miss D, okay, if you want to send your child out to be hunted down. That was pretty cool. I like that. Next, I wish we'd have done that with Justin. So he's probably watching. Sorry, son. Next Sunday during 10:30 a.m. worship, we got a concert, y'all. Simple Faith is going to be here. So pumped about that. And they will also be at the flea market on Monday, and our outreach at the flea market, 10, 11, and 12 o'clock. But be here Sunday, and if you can support them at the market, please do that. And I want to let you know, we will receive a love offering for them next Sunday, okay? Daily prayer, Nehemiah 2:18, which says, let us rise up and build. That's us to build up in the faith, but also the building project. So please be in prayer about that. And Daylon and Ashley, y'all still got some tickets left? All right, Couples Retreat is coming at the end of this month. See Daylon and Ashley if you want a ticket. It's a Friday night, nice meal here in the Fellowship Hall, and also part of the workshop that night. And then Saturday morning, a continental breakfast and a workshop then, all right? So, and those of you that have been praying, keep praying for couples in our church, amen? As the family gets stronger, yeah, and pray that they'll sign up. But as the family gets stronger, the church gets stronger. Amen? So be in prayer about those couples, all right? But see Daylon and Ashley for your ticket. Tithes and offerings given at the door as you leave in just a few minutes. But I want to show you this real quick. I got a little video for you, okay? It's only about 2 minutes. Check it out, the next series coming up.
Baggage. For as long as we've had stuff, we found ways to bring it along. Baggage started off big, but it got smaller, portable. Now one person can carry more than ever. Important stuff like clothes, toiletries, fancy little dogs, you know, necessities.
That's
but what's amazing is how much stuff we drag around that we don't need and don't like. Things that trip us up, wear us out, and box us in. Stuff like anger.
What is wrong with you?
Addiction. Overeating. And overspending.
It was amazing. They had such a great sale. They couldn't.
We carry around past relationships.
I don't know what I ever saw in you. I didn't even dress well. Gosh.
Worry. Unforgiveness. And selfishness.
I think that's a great idea, don't you?
I love it.
It makes us ask questions like, why did I do that? Or how did I get here? And what is wrong with me? Because this stuff is heavy. It's bulky.
I'm sorry.
It makes everything in life harder, especially relationships. You might not know where it came from or how you got it, but there's only one way to deal with baggage. Throw it down. Drop it.
Yeah.
Just let go. Sounds easy, but it's not. You carry something long enough, it feels like a part of you. You walk away, but a minute later, it's back in your hand. baggage tricky like that. You gotta keep dropping, keep throwing, keep letting go so you could take hold of something better. God's best for your life. And for that, you're gonna need both hands. We run fastest, love fullest, and live lightest when we let go of the baggage.
Amen. So the series is baggage. Anybody got something to let go?
Amen.
All right. We'll talk about that in the next 3 weeks. All right. I love you. Would you stand, everybody, around the house? All right. Father, we love you and praise you. What a sweet day in your house. Sweet day of study and prayer and giving, all of the things, and also restoration, reconciliation. God, knowing that we need you, and we're thankful that you've come to rescue us. We love you and we praise you, Lord. Give us an amazing rest of the day and week in you. And all God's people said, amen. 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 Love you, church.